rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of ancient believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born with a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. Let it rise above the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered on the ground. Of all the sons and from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none range truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory.
Aren't you glad Christ has risen from the dead? All the powers of darkness.
And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard. And all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. And all the powers of darkness tremble. All the powers of darkness can't drown.
up the dead to life in your love. God, you're always great.
Every wretched heart redeemed. drown our sins in seas of crimson. Hallelujah, death is beaten. Christ has risen from the grave. Hallelujah, it is finished. All to you, the highest praise. On that day, the uttermost,
all the darkness cannot
carry. Every shadow.
Thank you.
final breath he gave, as heaven looked away, the Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake.
Father, He is glorified. Reading from the 19th chapter of the book of St. John, just one verse. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15:17, "If Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, and you are yet in your sins." Verse 20, "But now Christ is risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming." Aren't you glad he did a complete and finished work? Yeah. I've heard people say we talk about the cross too much. We talk about his sacrifice. But I want you to understand something. We have no avenue of grace or salvation any other way. You see, there's not one human being on the earth that was ever able to live godly enough or holy enough on his own. The Bible said we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And you need to understand the reason for the cross, because the cross is not just something that happened. He was just not another religious leader who was executed. There are times when I talk about other faiths and other religions other than Christianity, and I talk about how, and I'm just going to be real, how inferior they are. Today I'm not even going to mention their names, because there's no name that even compares with the name of Jesus. His name is above every name, and at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that He's Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And the only way that justice could be met, you see, we deserve what we deserve for our sin and our penalty. We deserve death. We've all, you say, "Well, I'm not such a bad person." I want you to understand that, how many know about the Ten Commandments? "Well, I haven't broken them all." Well, Jesus said, "Gentlemen, if you look to lust, you've committed adultery in your heart." Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus said, "If you hate, you're a murderer in your heart." Anybody here never told a lie? If you raise your hand, that'll be another one. How many realize we're a pretty wretched bunch? And that's why I can't understand religious people looking down their nose on other people, like you're better than them. Listen, folks, it's only by His grace. But what happened at the cross, sin's demands were met. I've often used this illustration of a judge sitting in a black robe behind a desk, and there's a young teenage girl standing in front of him. And she's ran a red light and then sped off trying to get away from the police. And so the fines are pretty hefty. And the judge, being in a robe of justice, slams the gavel down and he says, "Guilty." But then he stands up from his judgment seat, takes off his black robe, and comes and stands beside her and reaches into his wallet to pay the fine, because not only is he her judge, he's her father. Now, I know that none of you dads have ever spoiled your kids, but aren't you glad the King of Glory, the Judge of all righteousness, declared that the wages of sin is death? He slammed the gavel down, then he took off his robe of judgment and came down here and paid the price on the cross for every one of us to have life. So God, being a merciful God, wanted to give us mercy. But how many's ever seen kids raised with absolutely no consequences for wrong? Just spoil them rotten. Now, none of you have ever done that. I know your kids are angels. Mine all have halos, but it's their horns that hold them up. But if there's never any consequences for the wrong, then they never understand the weight of what they've done. And so how could God be forgiving and loving and just and not just ruin His kids to where we never see the consequences for wrong? By coming and taking our place and suffering in our place on the cross. God, in the person of His Son, Jesus Christ, was willing to pay the debt so you and I could have life. And you know what happened when He said, "It is finished"? Everything He came to do, He had accomplished. And because of that, I can come to the foot of the cross. Wherever I am, it doesn't matter if it's in a church, if it's in my car, wherever I am, and I can ask Him to forgive me for my sins. I can repent of my sins. I can tell Him I need Him to be Lord and Savior of my life. And the Bible then says that God will lay all of my sins to His account and lay all of His righteousness to mine. Who wouldn't want a Savior like that? Somebody said, "Well, I think I can just make it on my own. I don't need Jesus." How dare you have the audacity to look at the sacrifice of the Son of God and say, "I don't need it." I say, "I'm here today, Pastor, for my family, but I know a loving God would never send anyone to hell." You're absolutely right. If you go, it will be because you've rejected the way to life. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me." And so I know that I'm saved. Does anybody know you're saved, that you're a child of God? And it's finished. It's a done work. "Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the children of God. The world doesn't know us because it didn't know Him. Beloved, now," everybody say now, "are we the children of God. And it's not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know when He is revealed, we'll be like Him, for we will see Him as He is." Titus, Paul says it this way in Titus 3:3, "For we ourselves were also foolish and disobedient and deceived, serving various lusts and pleasure, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another." Pretty good description. "But when the kindness of the love of God our Savior toward men appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy, He saved us through the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Spirit." Ephesians 2:8, "By grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourself. It's a gift of God." You see, the Holy Spirit of God does a work and you can be born again, filled with the Holy Ghost. His presence can abide in you and you can walk and talk with Him and have a relationship with the God of the universe, the King of glory. Amen. Nothing the world has to offer compares with a relationship with Jesus. So I know that I am saved. Point number one. But you know what? I'm body, soul, and spirit. The Bible says that God is a spirit. John chapter 4. "They that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth." And in our spirit, we connect with God through the Holy Spirit. But we also have a soul, which is your mind, will, and emotions. And we also live in a physical body, which the Bible calls a house, a tent, a tabernacle. How many thank God the real you isn't wrinkling up and getting old or bald? The real you, if you're a child of God, is eternal. So when I'm saved and I come to Christ, the spark of eternal life ignites my spirit, and I no longer walk around with a dead spirit, empty, always looking for something to fulfill me. You know what? I'm convinced a lot of people go to church, and even this church, don't go for years, but you never really have had a relationship with Jesus, because if you're in Christ, you're a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. You have new desires. You want to be different. Amen. You don't care what the world thinks about you. And then you don't need all the things that you had out there, because He fulfills. He satisfies. He sustains. Hallelujah. So my spirit, I'm saved. But my soul is in the process of being saved. James 1:21 says, "Lay aside the filthiness and overflow of wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls." And Paul says in Romans 12:1, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is just your reasonable service." Now watch this. And be not conformed to this world, but be you transformed. I want you to notice two words in the text, conformed and transformed. You know, I'm amazed at how people are conformed to whatever goes on around them. We have the nature of chameleons, don't we? Just want to be like who, and that's the destruction of your spirit, because if you hang with the wrong people, you become like them. Amen. But you don't have to be conformed. You can be transformed. How does it come? By the renewing of your mind. So after I'm saved in my spirit, then God begins a process in my life to where He begins to change my stinking thinking. Amen. How many know you need your computer reprogrammed once you come to Christ? Because you've had attitudes and habits and ways of reacting and responding that are not in sync with the Spirit of Christ that now lives in you. And so God begins to work where we have a relationship with Him. As we daily get into His Word and walk with Him, He starts changing our mind, will, and emotions little by little by little, till every day we become a little more like Him. And that's called growing in the Lord. How many know a brand new Christian? Going to do things that some of you folks that should be a little more mature in the Lord can't get away with. The pastor, does that make sense? Sure it does. I hear a little baby crying. That's okay. I'm using that for an illustration. Doesn't bother me. Doesn't bother me when that baby dirties the diaper. Never did. I'd just hand them to my wife. But how many understand if there's not a progression of learning and maturing, you begin to realize that something is wrong? And so God is saying to the people of Christ, when you begin to realize that you're saved, then you realize that you're being saved as well. Your mind, will, and emotions, the real you begins to change and come into sync with the Word of God and the Holy Spirit that dwells within you. Anybody thank God for the process? It means, it doesn't mean, you know, you're not perfect overnight. Matter of fact, some of you will fall and backslide and go away and come back. I did. The Bible says you're going to mess up. How about that? A just man falls seven times, but he rises up again. Now, just in case you're doing like Peter did with the disciples there and counting, well, they've offended me seven times today, so after seven, they're done. Jesus said 70 times 7. Amen. How many know the key is just getting back up? Anytime you see the word 7 in the Bible, it symbolizes completeness. So it doesn't really mean that you make so many mistakes. And then how many thank God He's not done with you? Your sin is not more powerful than the grace given by the cross of Jesus Christ. He will continue to forgive if you'll continue to come to Him. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sin, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So God is doing a process in our life of restoring and renewing our minds. Here's the way I like to put it. I'm surely not what I ought to be, but thank God I'm not what I used to be. Amen. And I want to encourage somebody here today, you started walking with the Lord, and because you fell and made mistakes, the devil said, you weren't saved to start with. I'm telling you, God's still got His hand on your life. God's still got a call on your life. He's still got a purpose for your life. Amen. And I'm just appreciative of the fact that when Jesus went to the cross and said, it is finished, I don't have to be concerned anymore about whether or not He will forgive me. Because would He, the Bible said, if He spared not His own Son, will He not by Him freely give us all things? You see, you can't sin so much that God can't forgive you. You sin so much you can't believe to receive His forgiveness. Because as you continue to live in deliberate sin, condemnation settles in on you, which, by the way, isn't from God either. And you begin to think of yourself as someone who could never be what God's called you to be. Well, I'm here to cancel the devil's assignment and tell you that you can be who God called you to be. And if you have slipped away and fallen away from Him today, I want there to be a resurrection in this place. Hallelujah. When the prodigal son came home, his father said, this is my son who was lost and is found. Listen, he was still his son out there in the pig pen. He was dead, but He is alive again. May resurrection power restore somebody in this place this morning. I was thinking about Romans 6. It says, we are buried with Him in baptism unto death. That as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should rise up to walk in newness of life. Thank God for the power of new life. You see, that's why baptism is the first commandment given after repentance. In Acts chapter 2, verse 38, they said, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is to you, your children, even as many as are far off, that's our generation, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. You see, I don't want to mess with your tradition, but to identify with Him, we need the power of His name, and we need to be immersed in the water. Amen. Because you don't bury a dead man by sprinkling a little dirt on him. You don't need to baptize a baby. Babies, they're covered. How many know that until the age of accountability, God's grace covers them? Baptism comes after we repent, and it says, I'm burying the old person that I used to be. I'm dying with Christ, and you can't breathe while you're under the water, but when you come back up out of that water, it's a symbol of new life. That's why the devil hates it. Say, well, I don't think it's important. You don't? Why Jesus walked so far to do it and to say, I've done this to fulfill all righteousness. It's the first commandment given to every believer. It is. When Jesus was baptized, the Holy Ghost descended in the form of a dove. And the Father said from heaven, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. And His baptism was a prophecy of what He was going to do. I'm going to be buried. I'm going to raise again so I can give life to you. Isn't that awesome? Thank God for the resurrection. Thank God that I am saved. But boy, do I still have some issues. Tell the person next to you, you still have some issues. That's pretty safe. Amen. But that don't mean you're not saved. How many's ever heard this? Well, I would go to church, but there are hypocrites in the church. Well, there are hypocrites everywhere. That bartender that you cry on his shoulder, he don't really care about you. He wants your money. But you still go there. I'll just leave it alone. And that dancing girl certainly don't love you. But you go there. You know what a hypocrite is? Somebody wears a mask. And a lot of them don't go to church. Some of them do. But come on, there's room for one more. I am saved. I'm being saved. And I will be saved. Because you see, while God is working on the soul through what He's already done in my spirit, how many know it's even changing and affecting the appetites of the body? But the body is from the earth and it's earthy. And we're not tempted to sin because God tempts us, but James says it's our flesh, our physical person that entices us and draws us away. But I'm telling you, there's a change coming. There's about to be the sound of a trumpet, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And we that are alive and remain will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. We're going to be changed, the Bible said, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. We're going to have a brand new body that is no longer earthbound, no longer pulled to the lusts of the flesh, but instead, the Bible said, it'll be just like Jesus. Now, He showed up in a real resurrected body. Cults teach that He just dissolved into gases and became a spirit. But He said to the disciples, touch me, handle me and see. A spirit hath not flesh and bone as I have. Now, there were precursors to His resurrection all through the Bible. Elijah raised the dead. Elisha raised the dead. Even when He stood at the tomb of Lazarus, He raised the dead. But they died again. But He came out in a brand new body. a transformed body. The old was there, but it was transformed into the new. And the only thing in heaven that's man-made are the prints of the nails in his hands and feet and the scar in his side. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thomas said, unless I can place my hand into the prints of his nails and thrust my hand into his side, I won't believe. And Jesus just showed up in the middle of the room. When I get a new body, I can travel at the speed of thought.
Amen.
Walls won't mean anything, but yet it's real. He said, come here, Thomas. And can you see? Handle me. A spirit doesn't have flesh and bone. And put your hand into the marks of the nails and put your hand in my side. Be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas falls down before him and he says, my Lord and my God. Jesus said, you believe because you've seen. Blessed are they who have not seen and yet have believed. See, sometimes when God don't answer your prayer right away, He got a bigger miracle for you. You see, Martha and Mary had always known that Jesus was a teacher and a healer, but they didn't understand who He really was. And Jesus was deliberately 4 days late by their calendar. And when He showed up, they're a little indignant. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. They both said that. If you'd have just been here. And Jesus said, well, he'll rise again. And she said, yes, Lord. Now, by the way, the Old Testament does teach the resurrection of the last days. Yes, Lord, we know he's going to rise again in the resurrection in the last day. And Jesus said this, I am the resurrection and the life. You see, God's let some things die and seem impossible. Some of your dreams that you thought God would fulfill have just died, and they haven't died without purpose. You see, something has to die before it can ever be raised. You've known Jesus as a healer, you've known him as a savior, but he wants you to know him as the resurrection and the life. And he said, Lazarus, come forth. And he demonstrated his power over death. God's given you proof of the resurrection all around you. The spring of the year, Easter, Resurrection Sunday, coincides with Passover, where a lamb was offered as not only for their redemption, but their deliverance from slavery. How many thank God the lamb has set you free?
Amen.
And it's in the spring of the year when everything around us looks like death. So many times I've stood at a graveside in a bleak winter morning or on a beautiful spring morning, and it don't matter. And I point around at the perfect proof of resurrection that God placed in nature. Paul said it this way in 1 Corinthians 15, except a seed die, it can't bring forth life. Jesus said, except a grain of wheat fall to the ground and die, it abides alone. Anybody here ever plant any corn? How many know you can't cut it right off the cob, put it in the ground? It has to be dead and dry. And that dead seed placed in the earth, hallelujah, whenever the warmth of God's sunshine and the rain of His presence comes down on that dead seed, what was dead brings forth life. And better life than before. You know, my new body ain't going to hurt. It ain't going to ache. Jesus even ate in that new body. I'm thankful for that. But I don't think you gain weight when you eat. I don't know about you, but I want that one. It's amazing to me that the promise that we have of life beyond this life. And he being first, you see, well, Pastor, do you believe when you die, you go to be with the Lord? I believe to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. But the Bible addresses that too. That's your spirit. How many know that you're not complete? How many know that when Jesus was just in spirit form, he went down, defeated the devil, and took the keys of death, hell, and the grave away from him, and got back up on Sunday morning, got in there in time to bring that body forth? And the stone wasn't rolled away so he could get out, honey. The stone was rolled away so they could get in and see that the tomb was empty. Just fantastic. And so I don't know if you're ready for this, but I am saved. I'm in the process of being saved, and that makes me ready for a change that's about to take place. Because He's going to return. Now, I've heard some people preach that that's already fulfilled and happened a long time ago. And Paul says that overthrown the faith of many. But the Bible talks about before that happens that Jerusalem will be a troublesome stone and nations will turn against Israel. And it names the nations that will surround Israel. How about that? The Bible said it'll be a time of trouble such as the world's never known. The Bible said it'd be like it was in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah and like it was in the days of Noah. Am I in the Word? The Bible said there'll be, now get this, the Bible said when these events are getting ready to happen, that when an event takes place on the earth, it will be able to be seen all over the world at once. Isn't that not incredible? How many know that until 10 years ago, there wasn't news networks that could beam things that happened to the entire world in an instant through the satellite systems? Jesus said there'd be powers in the heavens that would be shaken just before His return. Amen. Said there'd be a lack of natural affection. And perversion would be endorsed. Are you listening to me? And men would be crying peace and safety. And then comes sudden destruction. But I'm telling you, when it looks like it's about over, when it looks like the enemy's won, when it looks like on Friday, when He had breathed His last, that He was defeated, it's going to look that way again. But I want to tell you something. When you think it's just about over, there's going to be the sound of a trumpet. Hallelujah. And the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a shout. And those who have died and gone on before are coming back with Him. Their spirits will go down into that grave or wherever that body was. God can call the elements back into existence. In the moment, in a twinkling of an eye, everyone that was a believer will be raised with a brand new body. And we'll all be caught up together to meet Him. I believe it. Amen. Amen. You say, you really believe it? I believe it so much that it's my future.
Amen.
Amen. Hey, I tell people my retirement plan's out of this world. Now, we're not staying gone. How many know after that great tribulation, we're coming back on white horses to rule and reign with Him for 1,000 years. So not only am I saved and I'm being saved, but this old body's going to be changed too. It's going to be saved as well. Listen to Romans 8:23-25. Not only that, but we also who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, which is the redemption of our body. For we're saved in this hope. But what hope is seen is not hope. For what a man sees, why does he yet hope for it? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with perseverance. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 and 24. Now may the God of peace Himself sanctify you completely. Now watch this. May your whole, say it with me, spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless when? At the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He'll do it. I love this. Romans 8:11. But if the Spirit of Him who raised up Christ from the dead dwell in you, He will give life to your mortal bodies. Hallelujah. How many is filled with the Holy Ghost? His Spirit's in you. You got a promise of resurrection. Old Job is in the midst of the worst trial that's beyond his imagination. His children have been taken by death. His wife finds him repulsive. His wealth is gone. And at first he says, I wish there was a mediator. Job 9, I wish there was a mediator, a daysman between me and God that could lay His hand on both of us. In other words, he's saying, I wish there was a redeemer. But a few chapters later, God gives him a revelation. In the midst of his pain, in the midst of his suffering, he looks past the cross to the second coming. And he says this in Job 19:25. I know that my Redeemer lives and will stand at a latter day on the earth. And though skin worms destroy this flesh, yet in my flesh I'm going to see God. These eyes will behold Him and not another. Somebody shout, I know my Redeemer lives. In the darkness of slavery, the hope of African Americans here in America was that someday Jesus is coming. Someday there's a rapture. And they'd sing songs like, "Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, coming for to carry me home. Just like you raptured Elisha, come and get me, Jesus." And then they'd sing, "In that great getting up morning, fare thee well." Hey, listen to me, folks. There's a great getting up morning coming. It wasn't just him in the tomb. It's us as well. We're going to be changed to life eternal. Blessed be the God, 1 Peter 1, 3, and Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, who according to His abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope. Living. Aren't you glad we have a living hope? This ain't dead church. This is a living hope. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that doesn't fade away, reserved in heaven for you, ready to be revealed at the last time. For in this you do greatly rejoice, though now for just a little while, if need be, you're being grieved by various trials. Know this, that the genuineness of your faith is more precious than the gold that perishes. It is tested by fire, but it may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Would y'all come back up here and help me? Would you stand, church? Read it again. For the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And we who are alive and remain shall be caught up with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Thus we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. I want to ask you, I never do this, but I want to do this morning. If you just bow your heads and close your eyes, if you're listening to me this morning and you don't know that you're right with God, but you want to be, I'm not going to embarrass you. Would you just raise your hand so we can be in prayer for you? You want to be restored. You want to be saved. You want God to touch you. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. The Bible says if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God's raised Him from the dead, we can be saved. With the heart we believe to righteousness. With the mouth confession is made to salvation. God wants to give you your own personal resurrection in this place this morning. He wants to revive you from the trap and the sin and the trouble you've fallen into. I'm going to open these altars at this time as we get ready to sing. And if you come to pray, you want somebody to pray with you, just stand. There's elders that'll come and minister to you whatever your need. God wants to raise somebody back to relationship and life with Him in this place this morning. Hallelujah. Back when we were kids in the old Pentecostal church, we sung a song kind of went like this. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified, freed me forever. Woo! One day He's coming back, oh glorious day. One day the heaven was filled with His praises. One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin. He dwelt among men, my example is He. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified, freed me forever. One day He's coming back on a glorious day. One day they led Him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed Him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He.
Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Glory! Rising, He justified. Free me forever. One day He's coming back. Oh, glory.
Verse again.
One day the grave could conceal Him no longer.
Come on.
One day the stone rolled away from the door. Jesus arose, over death He had conquered. Now He is risen, our Lord forevermore. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Freed me forever. One day He's coming back. Oh,
sing it, church.
Day. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified. Freed me forever. One day He's coming back. Oh, glorious day.
You mean it.
Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far.